Yes, ladies and gentlemen, once again, a very warm welcome to the Reinvention Laboratory. For those of you who haven't seen me yet, I'm Corinna Egra, and I'm your host throughout this week in this laboratory. Today's sessions are on a variety of topics. We now talk about transformation to agile standardization. And we will show why we need the transformation of the current standardization and why we need to demonstrate an agile method. How we can pick up all requirements and intelligence to be able to describe the new architecture of the Internet of Things. For that, for the introductory speech, I'm very pleased to introduce our first guest speaker. It's Eva Zielinska. I hope I pronounced that correctly. And she is director of the External Relations Department of the Polish Committee for Standardization. And she has been secretary of Polish National Committee since 2012 and Senelec board member since 2014. Eva, the floor is yours. Please join me in welcoming Eva Zielinska.
Thank you very much. And first of all, I would like to thank you for giving me possibility to take part in this event. Today, I will share with you the new concept of creative standardization. We discussed it since some time in PKN internally, but now we think it's time to show it to the wider audience. And as you noticed, I use the plural form because I'm not the only author of this concept. My colleagues with which I discussed this are sitting here during the audience, and I hope they will help me to answer all your questions during the discussion time. And I would also like to invite you to take part in the discussion. If this concept of creative standardization would be the way or one of the ways to agile standardization. And I shall start from the very beginning, from the history of IEC, but it's only one slide, not more. Don't worry. And I refer here to the history of IEC because the Reinvention Lab is organized in the framework of IEC General Meeting. But I think we can put here any other international or regional standards organization and to discuss whether this creative standardization is possible to be implemented there. IEC was established in response to market needs, and it started from the need of unification of electrical machines and apparatus in the interest of commercial transactions and trade. And it took almost 100 years from the first experiments of Alessandro Volta with the electricity to setting up the commission. But at that time, the world was completely different. Now we cannot wait so long. During all these years, IEC developed and now is worldwide recognized international standards organization, acting in accordance with WTO principles, developing international electrotechnical standards, which are widely recognized and used all over the world. In IEC, we standardize different technical solutions. And over the years, we developed process and structures allowing for the development of standards and other deliverables as well. And the main steps of this process are well known for all of you. It's a definition of the new area of standardization, setting up of technical committee or system committee if needed, development of standards, of course, in accordance with WTO principles, and maintenance of standards, which is also extremely important. And this system works perfectly for defined topics and areas, and for us, it should be kept as such. And we call for this discussion today traditional standardization system. And we think that this traditional standardization system does not require substantial change in terms of rules and processes. This traditional system has to meet different challenges like timely response to market needs, addressing converging and fast-changing technologies, digitalization of industry, and addressing the fast-changing technologies very often going beyond the traditional areas of standardization, or use the contemporary means of communication or new IT tools enhancing the standardization work. but this traditional system is now confronted with the needs of contemporary market, needs of stakeholders, the new technologies, and very broad horizontal aspects which need to be addressed in the standardization process, like sustainability or widely discussed in Europe accessibility for all, or mentioned yesterday during the SMB meeting, electricity access. And committee structure does not work and will not work out in the future when you have to decide on the requirements with regard to a number of products that have to meet the different requirements at the same time. And meeting these requirements are dependent on the selected concept or selected idea. And the current structure, this current TC structure, is working properly if the overall concept is known and accepted by the industry and by the stakeholders. We can take another examples: car battery charging stations or smart cities. How many ideas, how many concepts we need to discuss before or to standardize before we will manage to standardize products for smart cities. It is very difficult, I would even say it is not possible, to standardize the ideas in the TC structures. So we need the new way to reach our goals. We call the IEC home for industry, and I think we need to discuss to make this home more comfortable and to find some space in this home to discuss the issues which are now discussed somewhere outside the IEC. Now, by standardization, we try to create future and we try to describe the future. This is an absolutely new task because nobody can risk time and money before standards will describe at least the general conditions. And using this traditional standardization system in these cases is non-effective because it does not fit for the process. So we should build a new type of standardization and we call it creative standardization. With this new creative system, we can try to standardize ideas, concepts, try to find widely accepted solutions. And here we put on the slide very simple scheme, just showing that at the beginning we have different ideas, concepts, then we have to develop process of creative standardization with the result of something we call creative standard. And this creative standardization could precede the traditional one. The result of the creative standardization could be a starting point for the traditional process. For example, in the creative part of the process, we discuss the technical solution that would be widely accepted by the market. And in the traditional part of the process, we standardize it. And both systems should be used in parallel in the future. Our new task is to prepare or to create this creative part of the process and then to transform or to prepare the traditional system to handle the creative and traditional standardization together. Because if we try to adopt traditional system to fulfill the task of the creative part of standardization, we will not reach our goals. We will spoil the traditional system instead. And according to us, this new creative system should be as flexible as possible and could take into account all aspects, implementation of which is very difficult in the traditional system, like, for example, open participation. Discussion whether the creative system should follow the WTO principles and national delegation principle would also be an option. At this moment, we don't have a ready solution how this creative part of the standardization system could work. But we think we should work out these solutions together. We should allow interested parties to develop the rules and processes according to their needs. So now we are rather asking the questions to you as well and would like to invite you to the discussion and to voice your opinions on the idea of the creative standardization. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Eva. We will put discussion to a little later point when we're all up here on stage. So we'll see you back up here. Ladies and gentlemen, Next is our first app poll of this session. And I'd like to invite you to take part in that. And well, you have probably all used the IECGM app already. You have probably seen one or the other poll in there. We have two kinds of polls, the main polls and the event-specific polls. And we do want to do such an event-specific poll with you right now. And we are happy if you take part in that. So please take out your smartphones and look at the main menu in the general meeting app. And then navigate to the Reinvention Lab agenda. And then select the session we're in now. And in the horizontal menu, tap polls. Now select with tap, take the poll, the option that you want to answer. And once you've voted, please, and don't forget to do that, otherwise we don't get your response, submit your response. You have to push that button. And we're not showing you the results at this point, because this time we want to do the same, or we want to ask you the same question twice. We want to ask it right now: will artificial intelligence replace the experts for standardization? Yes, fully, or yes, mainly, or rather not, or never. So we are interested to see how you vote now, and we'll take that same poll later at the end of discussion, at the end of the session. So, and then we will see what the two results are. So thanks a lot for voting right now. And I have the pleasure to now introduce to you our second speaker, who's already here, Dr. Matthias Uslar. He is head of Competence Center ICT for Smart Grids with an office, Institute for Information Technology in Germany. Matthias, methods of use case workflow visualization. That's your topic, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. So what I would like to present to you today is pretty much what I would call a picture worth a thousand words. So normally when you do systems development, you pretty much run into the issue that things are complicated, that you have a complicated requirements engineering process with various stakeholders, and that's especially true for stuff like system of systems, Internet of Things, cyber physical systems, Industry 4.0, or the smart grid. So I'm a member of the TC57, and I was also involved in the M490 mandate of the European Commission to send Senelec and ETSI to standardize the smart grid, and we as experts had the problem that we had to coordinate our work, and we have to come up with some kind of glossary, vocabulary, terminology, and visualization methods to actually have an understanding in our group to come up with meaningful standardization issues. And this is something I just want to put into my talk for you today. So basically, when people have requirements, they do not always state the requirements. This is a sketch which perhaps some people know about a child wanting to have a swing. So on the right-hand side, you see what was originally planned, and there you see variants. You have the apple swing, the eye swing right there. You can easily see it. You have also some kind of aspects of the swing. For example, what's the cost of the swing? So it's very expensive. What's the documentation of the swing? So it's all about systems, all about development and documenting all that stuff. And we always run into issues when dealing with that, and that's pretty much what this cartoon is more or less about. So everyone has got his own mindset. We think about things and we have certain expectations. When I go to a car dealer, he will ask me probably about how much horsepower, how much capacity in the trunk, etc. I will need. But he will not ask first, do you want a red car or a yellow one? So because that's normally not the main requirement when actually buying a car. We have like the system we want to look at, and the system has got a boundary, and we have surroundings for that. People discuss about those requirements, and then pretty much that's ambiguous, unfortunately. Sometimes even the red car is very important. So if you buy a Ferrari, no one wants to have a Ferrari which is not red, probably. Unless you want to go not in style, possibly. And We then come up with some kind of semi-formal description, at least in standardization. We have to document what are the technical requirements we afterwards want to have conformance testing, etc. PP for. So main questions are, what is the system actually used for? How do you use the system? Who interacts as an actor or stakeholder with the system? And where does the system boundary actually end? So what's the end of our system? Unfortunately, if you do that, you can still say, oh, I got like an idea of a smart device, but you see it comes in different flavors, colors, and shapes. So everyone has got its own idea and mindset about what the smart device actually is. So we have to solve that. But unfortunately, most of the time, people think, oh, okay, we agreed on some things. Now we know what a smart device is. In the smart grid, we thought, okay, we agreed what the smart grid is about distribution grids, transmission grids, voltage, frequency control, etc., auxiliary services, and then we wanted to standardize the communication between the individual components in the smart grid. We wanted to define the data exchange between the components in the critical infrastructure, and of course also have non-functional requirements like the timing requirements, security, interoperability, etc., in our standards. But that's pretty much what fails if you do not have a more formal approach, because usually people think about requirements, but they do not explicitly state them. So they fail at communicating those requirements to others, and often in the late stage of that process, it occurs that important requirements have been omitted from the start, and then the costs are higher or the devices already fail. So for example, if you look at the yesterday when I came here by plane, the purser said, oh, if you got like a Samsung phone, please throw it away, don't use it on the plane, don't put it in our trunk, because the requirements from the battery of the Samsung handy, it needs more space than which is actually in the cover, so it's a bit pressed, and then you can see, go to the technical committee dealing with batteries, because they can explain you why that thing explodes, even though it's not powered. So it's all about requirements, not to have bad technology at the end. In smart grids, it's easy. So that's a traditional grid. So this is one of the slides from TC57. This is how we see the world as a standardization committee, which assets we have, what the relations between those individual assets are. This is what we model, for example, in the IEC 61970 and 61978, the Common Information Model SIM for the smart grid. So this is my, I would call it, more conceptual slide, because all we do, all we have to model, adheres to a certain called meta model. So you have the system of interest, which follows an architecture, typically also defined by something like ISO, IEEE, IEC 42010 standards, which defines the stakeholders of the system of interest, the concerns of the stakeholders, defines an architecture description, defines certain viewpoints, so do I want to look at behavior or at static properties of the individual system, and I do a modeling. Modeling is always like shortening the reality to make it work for you. And for example, in that slide, I got the overview on a charging pole for an electric vehicle, for example. So all the questions you really need for developing such a smart charging pole are also covered by standards. If you know them, it's easy to apply them because it's a good system, which then gives you hints on how to trigger your requirements engineering process. Well, at the end, we found out, okay, that's what works in the M490 mandate, but also you see on that slide that you have different viewpoints. For example, this viewpoint on the child swing we have here is the viewpoint of a craftsman or a designer, so on the right-hand side it looks good. You see the measures between the individual parts. On the left-hand side, you can see that there are individual parts. If you buy it from IKEA, for example, you have to manufacture it pretty much yourself. On the other hand, you can dig deeper, so someone's responsible for the seat, so our seat department at the swing company has defined that pretty much explosion sketch for the seat, and that's pretty much the view of a constructor, and that's the client. So the client doesn't want to see the individual parts. It shall be complete, of course, but if they're already there, it will deal with that and only wants to have the product, and the other views are more or less in the specification and in the rollout process. So how does that all relate to the smart grid? Smart grid is a large, complex infrastructure. And in the M490 mandate, we had to deal with that infrastructure in a particular manner and say a picture's worth 1,000 words. So we had to look at individual aspects. For example, we had to look at the business processes, at functions assets are providing, at the information exchanged, at the communication protocols we had to use, and the components which were implementing certain standards like IEC 61850, et cetera. On the other hand, we looked at the value creation chain from generation over transmission distribution to the end customer, and on the internal organization of a utility. And this is pretty much when you have this three-dimensional cube, you could, in the mandate, put every five-digit number of a standard somewhere. It's pretty much not a whole architecture model, but it's more like a visual keywording, I would call it at least. And this is what we came up for. And we found out that aligns pretty good to the ISO IEC IEEE 42010, because stuff you elicit in your requirements engineering perspective also helps you paint that picture. Certain relations, just like concerns, architecture, viewpoints, stakeholders, are incorporated here. And we have a standard for that, of course, IEC General Meeting. So we used the IEC PAS back then, 62559, which was like a requirements template to come up with a good documentation for a power engineering, it was called back then, solution. And in the mandate, we came up pretty much to use the use case method, where we incorporate various stakeholders into our expertise and into our discussions, like experts from standardization, the domain experts, ICT experts dealing with the communication and implementation of the interoperability issues, and third-party users, of course, users from utilities, because if a standard is too complicated, people will probably not implement that. So our use case template was meant to cover all those four main stakeholder groups, and this is what we came up with. So we have a use case template for requirements engineering, a visualization of our technical solution dealing with various perspectives, like with our string. And the nice thing is that actually that works well with a smart grid. So, but we found out actually in standardization that we more or less provide actually a systems engineering approach, because our idea is pretty much based on architecture standard, on data management standard, on requirements engineering standards. And the method I presented from the smart grid perspective from the M490 was adopted in the Industry 4.0 model, in the reference architecture model Industry 4.0, for example, which pretty much resembled the SCAM cube you already had earlier on. And normally I would do now a demo, but that's a bit too cumbersome in an interactive session. So what you see here is an interactive tool we have programmed where you can actually visualize your solution. So you put in your solution, that's actually a yogurt filling plant here in the picture, and load a CSV file, and then you can easily visualize your, well, your solution based on the reference architecture model Industry 4.0. So you can zoom in. For example, here we have the various aspects we have in the RAMI. For example, you can model the assets, you can model the communication, you can model the actual business purpose of a solution. You can change that. Right here in the middle, we have the German joghurt becher, so the joghurt cup with the system actually filling it with a rather vast filling. The individual tanks, etc., with the maintenance processes, etc. So it's one here a toy example to actually come up with a meaningful way to document technical solutions from various viewpoints, to annotate standards, and also do analysis based on that individual visualizations of use cases. Because here you can just do a right click and see what technical standards are used, where's the asset located, what security requirements exist, etc. And also that you can export from the tool directly into Word or PowerPoint or Visio, sometimes if you wanted. So you can also use those figures you have from your solution in presentations and come up in the requirements discussion process with a meaningful way to actually discuss the technical solution, but also have a knowledge about the interdependence of aspects like communication, data, and the asset itself. And that's pretty much the end of my talk. I don't know if I'm on time because the timer wasn't reset, but I hope that this will trigger a discussion later on. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Matthias. Very interesting, and indeed we'll discuss later on all together. Ladies and gentlemen, our next step is to transfer the use cases into practice. And I'm pleased to introduce to you Dr. Christoph Timm, who is now coming right to stage. And he is head of Corporate Technology Technical Market Access at BSH Home Appliances Group in Munich, Germany, and has responsibility for technical regulation, standardization, conformity assessment, and test management. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor to speak today to you and implementation of use cases within testbeds, a few examples out of the industry which I'm working in. To give you an idea what is BSH, it's probably not so familiar for many of you. BSH was founded in almost 50 years ago as a joint venture between Bosch and Siemens back that time. And obviously was quite successful because nowadays we are number two as a manufacturer in our industry. And around 56,000 employees, 3,500 engineers working on new products and ideas. Since 2 years ago, we are 100% with Bosch since Siemens sold its shares. Probably more familiar for you are the brands which are produced by my company. Bosch and Siemens apparently very familiar here in Germany, but we also have some local brands. For those of you who are coming abroad, might be familiar with Dermator from USA, Balay from Spain, or Profilo in Turkey. Pretty much everything which is in the kitchen, in the household, and is driven by electricity is part of our product portfolio. So dishwashing, cooking, baking, washing, refrigeration, and consumer products. So much, just to give you an understanding, where do we come from and what does it have to do with the topic today? Because things have changed quite a lot in the last 50 years. Back that time, when the company was founded, a new washing machine was a solution for the family because it was a solution for hard and sweaty work and was a standalone solution. But that's not the case anymore. Today, with all the electronics, modern displays, mechatronic systems, sensors, and so on, a washing machine, oven, etc., can now be part of a larger system. And actually, outside, we have a good example in the corner where Home Connect is presented. We can show you the solution, which is already in place and could be seen today or could be even purchased. So today, home appliances can become a part of a system. It means within the house, by Internet of Things, they are communicating with each other. For example, when it's needed to for electric power from the solar panels, when the sun is shining high in the sky, you probably will use it or want to use it for the laundry, and later on for something else. So it means it's not a standalone solution. It has to be part of a larger system, and that also changes the requirement and the way how we develop and the way how we test our appliances. Here, just the example how it could look like in your house. It could be part of a local system. It could be part that you connect all the different appliances to a cloud, which is somewhere the service provided outside of your house. It depends. Both solutions have their advantages, disadvantages. But basically, the idea is we have entirely new field of applications which we can use. And that a washing machine is not just a washing machine, it's part of the system. Yeah, and that leads us to an entirely new problem, and you see it here on the slide. Things have to speak with each other. We need to have a common language that it's possible that devices and parts of different suppliers can interact with each other. And maybe a simple example, that you are able to integrate a printer from a manufacturer, whatever you want, from a brand, whatever you want, and it works with your setup at home. Standards are in place that it really works and is and can be operated without bigger problems. The theory, in reality, it looks sometimes a little bit different. I remember some months ago, I bought a new TV, of course, with internet function. It's an Android TV with great functions and features. But when I tried to connect it to my internet, it worked well. When I tried to connect it with my iPad from Apple, of course, I had that problem. So that's a reality right now. And also shows how important it is that we have here somehow a common language, that things are really working together. We call it interoperability. Now we come to testbed, because that's an important thing to really test our washing machine or our product in a new environment. And I just took out the definition from Wikipedia. You can read it easily at home. A testbed is a platform for conducting rigorous, transparent, replicable testing of scientific theories, computational tools, and new technologies. It came a long time ago from software development, but can be used also for many other applications in car industry, in a jet engine manufacturer, they are using that approach to test a new part or test a new machine in a standardized environment. So how does testbed work now in our area? I just brought you here an example how that complicated interaction between different devices and different components in a network could work. And here we use a logical model. It's the upside down pyramid here. And it starts with the use cases. So it's probably a good link to your presentation, because usually we would start to describe the requirements in the words, how the user would like to phrase it. Usually you would say, okay, I go to work today from 8 to 5, and during this time I would like to have my laundry done, but would like to use a solar energy. It's very simple, very clear in users' words, in customers' words, and it's important always to come from this perspective. Next step is to derive here, we call it generic use cases, that you have somewhere as standard, how to describe it. In our case, it would be a flexible start with some well-defined inputs and outputs. And yeah, this use case could be also applied for other users, not only for washing machine or an oven, but also, let's say, for the car when it's charged with electric power or anything else. Yeah. The programming structures, that's far down in the data model where the really interaction between the different appliances takes place. And on the right side, you see the different steps, how things are tested. You can imagine how challenging it is to find an environment where we can test it and that it's really working with every other partner. That there's no interference between two devices, two appliances, which you don't expect before. So it's a test model which needs to be set up, and the heart is now the interoperability test. And the test bed, which in our case is a mix of hardware and software components, where we are starting to checking out if everything is working how it's intended to do. So does the communication work? Are the messages delivered in a correct way? Are the interactions really completely done and closed? So that's an important part of the entire thing. And we use here a standardized testbed, which I come to the details a little bit later. Test suite to test it against the reference model. We call it a golden device to really complete everything and be sure that our appliance and our device also works in an environment with other partners which are not in any case available right now. Here you see the components of the testbed which we used. It's standardized, it's available by VDE. You can look it up in their website. And just some components here. The communication box, which is necessary because some of the partners, some of the components are not right in this place where you perform the test. They can be somewhere else, they can be somewhere remote. Using here a cloud technology helps to be here very flexible and also set it up and use a test environment which is distributed across a country, across a larger place. On the top you see just a test protocol on the one side and the results on the other side, so I don't like to share too much or use too much time here. Important to know is that testbed could be set up very flexibly. It means not only in one place, there's no need that you have all components and all partners in one room or one place or one building. You can set it up very flexible using a cloud. You just need to have that communication box and then you can make any kind of test which you need to integrate the washing machine or the device which you are setting up and producing into that environment and get reproducible results. That's important that you have a standardized environment where you get results which you can compare to what you have seen before. For those of you who had the chance to visit the trade fair IFA in Berlin just a few weeks ago, VDE did show the testbed there. And actually you see here two appliances from two different manufacturers. So it's not only the washing machine on the left-hand side is from my company, the dryer on the other side is from a different company. You also see here components of a heating system, solar power management, and other devices. And the idea was to show how these different appliances are working, interacting with each other, in an environment for energy management. Example which I used a little bit earlier before, that the washing machine runs its cycle when energy is available, when other other consumers in that network don't need so much energy. So that's the game which could be played in a very intelligent way within the house. Here I hope in a second or so a little movie will start on the black box on the right side. Okay. It's just a different example, and it comes out of virtual reality. Virtual reality, most of you are probably familiar with, and unfortunately, the little movie doesn't work. But here we also see great possibilities to make simulation, to have an environment where you can perform tests in an early stage of development projects and development processes. without preparing any piece of sheet metal or steel. And here in this case, it's just a person walking in that virtual room and having the possibility to try out a new technical concept without any, as I mentioned before, any piece of equipment is really available, with the exception of the computer and the software. Its simulation for us as technicians is it's a great opportunity and is also an approach very similar to the testbed idea. So what does it mean for standardization? The entire Home Connect is on one side a completely new field which we have to deal with. Our appliance is not only the standalone solution in the household where it has to meet safety and performance requirement, it also has to talk with other partners in the household. And it has to work there. And the other concern on another field of what we have to deal with is just the speed of development which we are facing right now. If you see how fast it is in computer technology nowadays, how fast new models of smartphones, tablets, and so on are coming to the market with new features, with new ideas. That's an incredible pace, which we also see coming up in our industry, which comes with more traditional products. And here we also see the need to come with ideas how we can deal with that pace and with this requirement in standardization. And that fits very well to your presentation earlier. I'm happy that you mentioned that. From my point of view, just in the IEC world, that round table idea, the systems approach, which has some very meaningful tools and aspects which could be helping here. Also, the second page, not for reading through, and I don't want to exceed my time and get lost here in the details. Also, the conformity assessment, which is described here in the documents, are available, which could be an approach also to meet requirements which are coming out of this new field in industry. Yeah, I'm now coming to the end and would like to summarize and from my point of view, on one side, that entire Home Connect is for us in our industry a new field which we have to play in, where we have new requirements to meet and need new methods to make it work with other partners. We also have to work in standardization on these new aspects. We need the standards urgently because they help us to free our energy for the innovative part of our development work. And all the basic requirements like the interoperability should be covered in standards. From my point of view, the testbed approach might be also an idea to be used in development of new standards. You apparently all the ideas has to be discussed in consortia, in groups, etc. Maybe in some cases we find a testbed environment which helps us to get this process supported. And last but not least, in our standardization work, we are very well covered with also traditional fields like product safety, product performance. But all these new questions regarding Home Connect, completely new business cases which haven't been available before or haven't been in place before. I'm just referring again to what we presented on the last trade fair in Berlin, a new environment platform with a software development kit where people from outside could have access to our products and come up with new ideas. how to work with a washing machine, how to download recipes to an oven, etc. These are all great ideas which open up an entirely new field. And here we see the need that we also have to define standards to make things really happen, to meet requirements like the interoperability, also in the long run, and to support it. You can read it by yourself. We have already ad hoc groups here in place who are working with, mainly from smart grid and building. And I would like, if that goes one level deeper into those applications which are relevant. Which are relevant for us. I'm at the end of my presentation. I hope I could share a few ideas for you which are valuable for the further discussion. Hope for many more discussions during the week, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Christoph Timm, and you will also join us for discussion in a little while. Thank you. Certainly. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we will now move to a very interesting topic, which is artificial intelligence. And it's my pleasure to introduce to you now Professor Hans Schotten, who's right there already, of the DFKI, which is the German Research Center for Artificial Intelligence. He's a member of the management board of that research center, and he's professor at the University of Kaiserslautern here in Germany as well. He will talk about the revolution of standardization with artificial intelligence. Professor Hans Schotten, the floor is yours.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
You can use that to scroll.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you very much for the introduction, and I also would like to thank the organizers for the honor to have the possibility to talk to you today and to share some ideas. And in particular, I would like to thank the speakers in the session that somehow prepared the ground for my presentation. I'm not a standardization professional, so certainly I will not be able to somehow have these to somehow communicate this deep insight in standardization processes, but I might be able to provide some visions from outside on the way forward. So it was a little bit stressed that this is about artificial intelligence. I assume that you have a rough idea about what artificial intelligence is. I do not plan to give an introduction or tutorial on artificial intelligence, but to look at standardization. So what I can probably skip are these WTO criteria that were already mentioned, and of course this is a kind of a boundary that we have. But when looking at this from outside, from research perspective, of course we don't care about boundaries. You know, that's not something that researchers care about. Nevertheless, we are aware there is something like transparency, openness, etc., all things listed here that we have to care about. And in Europe, for the European standardization system, of course, we have our directives. But these things can be changed if required. So that's one of the questions that we have. I'm more looking at this from the motivation that the stakeholders, that the players in the market have for doing standardization, because this is what we can't change. So if nobody wants to do what we plan to do or what we are looking into, then we are of course dealt with our ideas. And okay, so we have the official thing why we are doing standardization: compatibility, interoperability, safety, repeatability, quality, etc. All these things were already mentioned, and this is, of course, why we do standardization, and we all know that we need standardization to do so. Also, enabling commoditization of formerly custom processes, that is also something that is not an official goal, but certainly something that motivates many players. From my background and before becoming an academic player, so I used to be director for standards, so it's not completely in a semiconductor company, so I used to work in standardization for several years, and my feeling is that at least in some areas in the tech companies, of course, the real motivation is to generate mass markets, to coordinate R&D efforts with other companies in order to be more efficient and avoid running in directions and investing R&D money in areas that will probably never make it into markets. And then partly looking at this from a society point of view, also to guarantee that certain needs of the society are fulfilled so that niches have an ability to survive in the competition with a big mass market where the money is done. From my point of view, it's important to understand this because there are these tech companies that look at this, and yes, compatibility, interoperability are key enablers, but we should always understand that there is a business behind. And at the end, design follows business, at least that's my experience. And interoperability is important as long as there is a benefit. We have more than enough industry domains where companies don't care and don't like it because they feel that their silo systems are better. So, what are the challenges resulting from this? And I already pointed to the fact that I'm well seeing challenges that might really question the idea of standardization is definitely what we would like to do. But before talking about this too much, so that you don't get the feeling that I have a problem with standardization at all. So I'm coming from communication, from mobile communication. And what we achieved in the last years, that you can take a mobile phone and switch it on wherever you are in the world, and you get connected, and you can dial a number, and you can reach everybody in the world. That is something that only standardization was able to achieve. And I think that is a really dramatic innovation that was absolutely unimaginable before it was implemented. So I know how powerful standardization can be. Yeah, and that is something that today is commodity for all of us, that has probably changed the world, that is the key enabler for somehow making the world connected, and that is an achievement of standardization. Yeah, so it is probably the most powerful innovation that we have behind many other innovations, that we have this kind of global standardization and we're able to implement it. But we should never somehow rely on the success stories, and there are many success stories when we talk about any kind of networks, whether it's transportation, power grids, communication, they all depend, in particular, of course, the networks, on the success of global standardization. But there are challenges. So the world is getting more and more connected. And that, of course, in itself means there is an increasing need for standards. And there is an increasing need for standards between different domains. Yeah, and currently innovation in many areas, smart grids, we have seen here, white goods, we have seen, yeah, the energy sector are depending on making things connected, which means we need more standards, which also means people will more carefully look at standardization and how well it's implemented. We have another problem, which is innovation cycles. They are becoming faster. Yeah, that is partly, of course, a side effect of the success of mobile communication and the internet. Yeah, so that is, of course, we get the consumer in. Consumer would like to see things being accelerated faster and faster, and that means that the standardization processes need to catch up with these faster and faster innovation cycles. We have, of course, globalization with all its pros and cons, with the effect that we get a kind of a cultural and technology harmonization. Something that is currently increasingly questioned. Yeah, so there is certainly a question mark whether we like this at all, in particular since product harmonization obviously results in technology harmonization in cultural harmonization. But there's of course also the option of hybridization. Yeah? So whether globalization necessarily results in cultural and product homogenization or whether hybridization might be a second option is currently one of the fights. And on the other hand, we have a strong trend towards personalization, customization, the things that in Germany we tend to call batch size one, production industry 4.0. that is this batch size one, which for the production is kind of personalization and flexibility. And now, of course, we get the question, what is the impact of these two trends that look contradictory, but that can very well work together? Yeah, so these are two sides. There is a fight, but it seems to be a constructive fight of these two trends, because personalization, enabling personalization, can help to get a kind of a hybridization of the technology that avoids cultural homogenization that we don't want to have at the end. Yeah, so we would like to preserve kind of cultural diversity while benefiting from product homogenization. And that is something that standardization, and in particular those organizing standardization, have to be aware of. Yeah, this is a non-trivial process, and it needs to be understood and reflected that this is something, a responsibility towards society when doing these kind of things. Okay, and then finally, of course, cost pressure. Okay, that's not really a big surprise. So related to standardization, where's the cost pressure? Of course, we need to be faster, but we also have the problem with the IPR battles. Yeah, so we all have this kind of discussion. Are standards resulting in a situation where people can somehow blackmail industry domains by essential patents or not? Is this a problem or not? I was involved in some of these really big cases, and yes, of course, that is also a kind of responsibility to be aware of this process. And there is something where I would say standardization might be able to help to avoid these disadvantages. Okay, one of the things that I didn't mention by name but was on the slide is horizontal versus vertical. So the whole world getting connected. So we are having currently a situation where we have vertically integrated industries like Industry 4.0, logistics, company IT, process automation, product automation, energy, transportation, some were already mentioned. And we are having in some areas a standardization that is organized along horizontal technologies. This is in particular, of course, the 3GPP, Etsy world, the IETF world, the IEEE world. And we have organizations that are organized along verticals, so the value chains in certain industry domains. This is often how the verticals earn their money. This is how technology companies earn their money. This is how one standardization group is working. This is how the other one is working. We are obviously, currently, from my point of view, having a little bit of problem with this matrix structure because it results in an overlap. At least there is a risk that we get an overlap, that we are having gaps, and that we need to deal with this matrix structure of the different standardization organizations. It is understood, and there are, of course, collaboration agreements. I'm aware of this. The question is, are they already perfectly organized, and can we help to somehow navigate in this landscape of different standards, because it very obviously means that we need to collaborate. So we have bits and pieces of certain standards, yeah, in the vertical domain and organizations working in this domain and others coming from this domain. And obviously there is a risk of an overlap, potentially resulting in contradiction. There is a risk of gaps, yeah, potentially making it difficult to guarantee interoperability, and there is a need to somehow find a solution. And there is also the conclusion, so we are building solutions, reusing certain components for different solutions. And if we now increase the granularity of the standards, the question is, can we somehow automate the process of engineering standards, in particular for the vertical domain, out of the bits and pieces that are available. Something that some companies call standard engineering. It actually means, yeah, I try to automate the process of finding a solution for certain use cases by looking at all the standards and putting the bits and pieces automatically together. Yeah, then I need to understand this landscape, and I need to understand how the different organizations work together. And that this is more than just a technical question is, I found this wonderful table on a webpage from MAPI Foundation. It somehow highlights a little bit this conflict between the vertical and horizontal standardization activities. And if you look at the language, not looking at the content in detail, but at the language, you will find, okay, it is more than a pure research question. Yeah, it's obviously something that at least some association find is a question of philosophy and even politics, how this is organized. Yeah, as said, that is a kind of a picture highlighting contradiction. There is not really a contradiction. So it was understood that we have to deal with this, and there are the agreements and there are the talks between the different groups, in this case here, Industry 4.0 group and the IAC. So no reason to be afraid. Okay, so the role of standardization in the innovation cycle, and then I will come to the question, what can we do to, what can we potentially do to somehow evolve this? This is a very simple, there are many innovation sequence pictures in the world. I took the most simple one, invention, innovation, diffusion. Yeah, and of course with the standardization and the different activities around standardization, we are typically in the innovation area. So invention is research, is generating IPR. Then we go to the innovation where we often say, okay, that's standardization. Some people might to see it in between. And then finally, we have the diffusion with production and marketing and innovation. We have the standardization that is closely related to IoT, so the interoperability testing, which is, of course, one of the key motivations that was very nicely already described, test beds already described. So one of the challenges that we have, how do we get from invention to innovation? Currently, there is this somehow world or this image of the valley of death between invention and innovation in the innovation sequence that is nicely shown here in a picture that I've stolen from a US congressman. And it somehow indicates we are having a problem with some innovations, and I think creative standardization might be a solution. It points in this direction. So not all good ideas that we have on the research side really end up in standardization. These are different people, they have different methodologies, and there is a risk of this valley of death. I wouldn't say that it's so bad as it's shown here in this picture, but it's definitely, of course, dangerous. And I think it's always valuable to think about how can we guarantee that this is this problem is avoided. And in particular, how can we make the ideas and what we already have on the standardization side available to the researchers? And that is also related to mapping, of course, IPR. If you say, okay, I don't care about researchers, but you will probably care about guys dealing with IPR because they are just moving around more money. And so if I have an innovation, if I have an IPR, I would like to understand the role that it might have in a standardization framework, and I would like to check this. Today, that's almost impossible. Standards are not, patents are not written in a way that make it easy for a researcher to understand them. That's not the idea of writing a patent. Yeah. So that is, of course, something that is related. If I do an invention, and there would be an automated tool that shows me the role in a standard, yeah, then it becomes much easier to understand this, and we would suddenly have something that is disruptive for the patent business, because we would automatically see, okay, this plays a certain role in a standard. So if we would be able to automatically decompose a standard in key inventions, yeah, then we have a process to simplify this. That is also part of this value of that, yeah, and that's why it's important. Okay, so now looking into visions, what could be done? I have defined three steps. So, of course, the question is there a need to do anything? For researcher, yes, of course, there is a need to do something. Yeah, so standardization, as I said in the beginning, has been super successful, but there are challenges, and I hope that you believe me, the challenges are significant enough to force us to move. Yeah, so we can't just say, okay, we are not doing something. And so what could be done when we talk about the three kinds of innovation: evolution, revolution, disruption. Disruption being the destructive part of the evolution. Evolution. So we all know the XML spec, and everybody probably has already worked on having standards defined in an XML format so that I can automatically verify protocols. That was done in 3GPP in the 90s. I was somehow involved in this, where we tried to define a standard so that radio protocols can automatically be verified. It comes back all 5 years, and with the success of artificial intelligence, so systems that can automatically do deduction. So we are currently in the fourth generation of artificial intelligence, 70s, 80s, 90s, and now we are in the fourth generation where we have kind of hybrid systems. Yeah, of course, we have the means to do this in a very elaborate way. So we can very efficiently test things if we are able to break them down in a language that can be used for deduction. So the kind of steps that probably all of us know and agree to that we need them is the evolution, so requirement engineering, the automatic identification of generic enablers and functionalities, so the decomposition of the functional requirements, the identification of appropriate standards, so looking for who is doing what if we have the XML description, and finding the interfaces between the different standards in an automated way, in particular resolving the conflict between vertical and horizontal standardization, so bringing this automatically together, what I call standard engineering. So an engineering of a new standard, particular for vertical solutions that we have in an automated way based on what is already available. So generating standards out of standards or profiles out of standards, identification of overlaps and gaps, and somehow listing these kind of things. That is all something that we can definitely do. And first projects trying to do so are already starting now because we realize the use cases, in particular in the vertical domains, are so variable and so different that really doing this with paperwork in TCs might not always be a solution. We can even do conceptual interoperability tests between solutions of different groups. So that is in particular relevant when you talk about connectivity. So when we start to talk about having these 5G networks that are supposed to connect everything in the future, we get different services and service requirements in and have to fulfill. We are defining so-called generic enablers that we provide to all, and we need to see as part of the virtualization story and what we call network function virtualization, how we can automatically use service chaining orchestration to build these kind of solutions. And at the last thing on the evolution side, helping to solve this IPR problem by helping to decompose things that allow us to identify or to find a mapping between where patents fit in certain standards is something that in principle is possible. It's definitely the hardest part of this evolution story. Next step, revolution. So the first thing was really paperwork, working on XML and generating paper out of paper, XML out of XML. The next thing that is currently under discussion is a revolution where we try to somehow say, okay, we are generating products out of specifications, where product is something that is, of course, has to be seen as a little bit carefully. So the idea is that we say, okay, if we have a standard, and if we have with the XML virtualization story the possibility to understand what's happening, then we can also add this to products and say, okay, this product will, if I enable it, do certain tasks in a way that are conform with certain standards. And it might even provide the audit documents required for this. You will say, certainly, we are already doing this today. Yeah, in the in all safety critical industries, that's already happening. Yes, but it's not automatically happening. Yeah, whenever a standard is changed, the products will not change. It's not automatically tied together. It's not that I buy something and the machine will automatically guarantee whatever I have as a standard, that will be guaranteed. Yeah, that's what we don't have today. And that will actually mean that we add value. So standards or standard defining organization might move into this area and say, okay, we provide a software that comes with certain products and guarantees that certain classes of requirements are always fulfilled and automatically the audit documents are generated. That isn't true added value. I would never in the future have to care about this anymore, and that would really add to the value of the machines and the tools that I'm producing. And I would probably be willing to pay for this. Yeah? So that is kind of a revolution because it actually means, okay, we do something completely different in standardization. We add in the value chain something that is beyond pure standardization. And then, of course, disruptive. The question is a world in which we don't need standardization something that is possible? And I think, at least from a research perspective, it's fun to think about this. So, somewhere, the first two people speaking different languages met. And somewhere, the first dictionary or translator program between these two languages was created. So, in principle, you can talk to each other if you have no clue about the language the other one is talking. So, that's what we all did. So, there is no point in saying, we need to have it. Yes, it is super inefficient. Yeah, it is super inefficient, but in principle it's possible. But with the success of artificial intelligence, I can tell you, these processes are accelerated. And yes, we are able to generate protocols that are negotiated between two sides automatically. Yeah, so they have their needs and experience, and you can do something like unsupervised learning processes where without having a common basis, yeah, you can start to communicate by learning from each other. That's what all of us can do, yeah, because we are all learning this from our mother. Yeah. As said, it's not super efficient, but we already know that it's possible. And that, of course, means we can think about this. First steps in this direction are currently evaluated. So there are projects, for example, for network management. Sorry for, again, using an example from this direction, but that's where I'm coming from. So where for 5G network control, we are indeed evaluating whether we can have tactical decision-making as autonomous function in a network. There is the SelfNet project doing this, yeah, where they are negotiating with each other certain processes. Okay, and with this, of course, we have the question, is this possible? I do not believe that we will see, that will have a strong impact, yeah? But we should take into account that there are some problems where we can well live without standards, and to do standards for everything is probably not the best solution because it will always be a little bit slower. And we should be aware that somewhere there is a point where certain things, only certain selected problems, might easier be handled without standards. They always rely. So when two guys negotiate, of course, they use electromagnetic waves and they need to have an understanding of modulation. That would be too complex to learn through all the layers. Yeah, but on certain layers, you can well do so. And we have to respect this and we have to embed this in an overall strategy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hans Schotten. Am I on air?
Am I? Yes, no. Thank you very much. Stay here with me because we now do our little panel discussions, and I'd like to ask Eva and Christoph and Matthias back on stage here And I guess we'll just gather around this little table here, and this is your microphone. Thank you. And ladies and gentlemen, we have had quite some vivid discussions before, so if you feel like you want to contribute, you have a question to one or the other of the speakers, you may just ask your questions. We have microphones prepared, but if you do so, we'll be very happy if you just tell us your name and the country or the organization where you come from briefly. So. There's a question already. Yes.
It's Roland Hussein from Canada. And for the last speaker, when you look at the birth of a product and the birth of a standard, does the standard setting body get in the way? Because I think the last part you mentioned, I think is very important in that those who make the product and those who want to have the product speak to each other from different manufacturers are the ones who should create the infrastructure for the standard so they can talk.
Yeah.
So sometimes I believe the standard setting body gets in the way and slows the process down.
Yeah, so that is certainly a question that is currently discussed on very high strategic levels, yeah, because you can, of course, have mutual dialogues. And with having more and more smart products, you know, it becomes more and more difficult and complex to somehow define and standardize communication so that people start to talk about doing this in a mutual way and not to have standardization anymore. In particular, when the communication starts to become one of the key assets of two companies, yeah, then there is, of course, currently a tendency that I'm aware of, to somehow keep standardization out in order to block third parties to enter this ecosystem and other reasons. It's a fair argument. We have always seen this. So there have always been silos and there have always been efforts to somehow attack silos. Yeah? And that is a discussion that is, of course, heavily linked to standardization. And there are pros and cons. Some people and some companies died because they were too late in opening up their interfaces. On the other hand, the tendency to say open is always good because it sounds like basic democracy is naive. Yeah, because there is a success of Apple. Yeah. So and currently. There is a little bit tendency in even on the communication side to say let's handle more on the IoT sector, yeah. By having since the standards become so complex that customers often anyway would like to see a label for successful IoTs, and if I anyway have to run through the IoTs, then why the hell should I go for a standard? That is happening. So it might be that at the end. The IoT organizations and IoT camps define profiles, they're currently calling it, and that become pro forma standards.
Thank you. Eva, to go back to your creative standardization, the new tools Matthias presented, I'd like to know how, for creative standardization, you see those tools and if they are practical and daily work for you.
Well, I think the app. Am I heard?
Yes, or? Yes. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think they are practical, but they are practical at the level of the traditional standardization, I mean in the implementation of the standards, but also in the development of traditional standards. I think that the creative standardization would rather answer to the question of our colleague, because he mentioned that sometimes the standardization process is too slow, yeah? That we should start to talk before we start to standardize products in the traditional way. Mm-hmm. So it's that I think that's the space for the creative standardization.
Mm-hmm. Yep. To be honest, it sounds complex to me.
Yeah. It is, because it is rather, I would say, philosophical discussion than the technical one. It's my impression.
Yes, and so I'd like to know from you, Matthias, if complexity doesn't mean longer time for a development of consensual standards, and if that is not the reason for the rise of foreign consortia.
Well, good question. So honestly, I have to say complexity is the problem itself from my perspective. So not the time perspective you're bringing into that, because I think, I mean, perhaps I'm not the agile guy in that round, but I think a good standard takes some time. You cannot just come over the weekend, because we have some coordination processes. All the experts we involve are typically doing a lot of stuff in their spare time, and they're not necessarily paid by their employer for that. But they have important knowledge, and to incorporate those people in the process, it really takes some time to get the state of the art from the experts into standardization and make them documenting it into according to the draft we have for a standard, and then come up with a good CDV. So I think we can speed up a bit, but I would deal more with the complexity in terms of the knowledge than in terms of the time it takes, because from my individual perspective, I think standardization will always take some time and should take some time. And I think the agile approach is good to actually incorporate that into the requirements elicitation process upfront, to have like an agile way to discuss between the individuals, between the people, and of course the stakeholders giving out the requirements, because we do not just invent a standard without purpose. There are requirements from stakeholders coming to standardization, and this is what standard is. And I think this is the process, the step in the process where you can actually come up with the agile stuff.
But okay.
Well, that's only my opinion.
Yeah, Eva, you agree that?
Yeah, I totally agree, because I agree that to have a good technical standards, we need a time, and that should be prepared timely on market, of course, but with following the established procedure.
Okay.
But that's all. The technical standards should be prepared like this now. But we can start earlier and discuss about the ideas and concepts. So I agree with Matthias.
I've seen a question here from the audience. Your microphone is just on the way.
Thank you. I'm Lorenza Iechia from UNECE, one of the UN agencies. And my question is about smart cities and how this many of the ideas that we discussed this morning, from test beds to agile standardization and more, could be or are already discussed in the other work areas that you have on smart cities. And so the question is to the panel. Thank you.
So cool. Who wants to comment on that?
Yeah, of course. So since I'm doing critical infrastructures with smart grid, I'm also familiar with the smart access. So of course, smart city is something like where you incorporate stuff like health, public security, traffic, and energy. So as an energy guy, I always say, well, our critical infrastructure is the backbone of everything else, so you should adhere to our method. One infrastructure itself is already complex, and if you combine them, you will have a hard time coming up with a consensus. Because I was there in Berlin at a German meeting, and we discussed, there were people actually dealing with traffic, someone dealing with transportation, and one with public security. And there's no overlap between the people and the stakeholders. So I think it's you're having a hard time actually to come up with a fully fledged tool chain and model to deal with that. But I think the liaisons between the individual TCs and standardization groups help a lot. And I think also each individual member country is somehow bringing it into higher levels in national standardization. For example, in Germany, we also deal with, we have a smart city roadmap for standardization. And I think this is where the individuals from the critical infrastructures shall support the upper level in order to have meaningful requirements to come up with a consistent, safe, and secure, and reliable smart city at the end.
Does that answer your question? Is there maybe something you want to add to that from your perspective?
Yeah, smart cities is definitely on a larger scale, a very similar scenario. In a smaller scale, in a household, we also have the different devices who are interacting with each other, and sometimes have to negotiate. So that's just on a different scale. Same question. And as I outlined in my presentation, the interoperability between that's one of the key topics. No? If we fail here, the entire idea will fail. If you are doing here a good job in standardization and making it easy to the customer to integrate new systems and also integrate his system into the power grid, for example, then it will be successful. No? So it turns around again. How does the world look from a customer perspective? What needs does he have? Of course, easy access, easy use of his appliances, and don't want to flip through hundreds of pages of manuals to get his things connected. So, no matter what perspective we look at, these standards are essential for a success of Internet of Things or connected home or connected city.
We have one more question from the audience, but I'd like to ask you first, what support can practical tests parallel to the elaboration of standards play for you? What's your view on that?
Yeah, as I said, standards are important that also the base work is working well, that we can focus our energy on developing new use cases. So testbed idea is something to have a stable environment somehow a well-defined environment where you can try out a new scenario, a new device, a new component within your network. And that also would be an idea for standardization, to work with that idea. How can we use that method? How can we use that methodology to develop our standards, to test whether the use cases are applicable to what we want and deliver the results which we have intended to.
Mm-hmm. And gain some time with that. Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay, that gentleman over there.
Working?
Yes.
Right. Siak is Blaise. I'm working for AFNOR in France. I'm also on TC69. I was very happy to see that our existing method for standardization is good and it works very well. I'm not quite of that opinion. I think that use cases and the standardization that follows is very subject to vested interest. And it's very, very subject to the personality of the people who are present. This is a major problem. And the second problem for once a standard is established is that we have meetings every 6 months, every year sometimes, if it's active, actually every 4 months. It's obvious that this does not allow a correct exchange of information. This has to evolve in some way using modern technology, using a blog type approach, using the possibility for people to comment on comments, accumulate the comments, analyze the comments, perhaps with intelligence. But at least so that when we come to meetings, a large part of the work is done and we can get to the real work. This is the case for use case meetings, which are exactly the same, which work in exactly the same way as long-term standardization. The same influence of influential person, loud-voiced people, people that you can't stand because they're impossible to work with, and so on. And somehow we have to address the personality problem also at IEC, which is strictly not addressed.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Do you? Yes.
Yeah, actually, you mentioned a very important point, and I would like to add that we also have new stakeholders in that game, no? Especially when it's coming to connectivity. Currently, we are very good in the traditional field of product safety, product performance, everything what we need to build up a washing machine, an oven, a dishwasher, or whatsoever. But the connectivity, with all the use cases which will be developed now also by people outside of the industry, outside of our space of influence, this also might have an important input for the standardization work. So this round table idea to also include other stakeholders, maybe sometimes consortia, groups of companies who are establishing a new standard, because they have to do something to get their telephone, their smartphone connected to each other. Now, many of those standards which we are talking about with smartphones are, yeah, just came up with some consortia and were put into a formal standard afterwards. No? So these are all influences which we have to bring into the work. Maybe there's a better idea somewhere around. Our idea was that system approach which gives us some tools, and certainly we have to think about even new tools, like mentioned here with block systems, to just support the discussion which is necessary to get all the content boiled down to the essence which we need in the standard.
Mm-hmm. Do we have more questions from the audience? Hans, you mentioned,
Can I briefly add something to this and the question before? So that was a little bit, so number one, I agree with what you said here, and I share the concern behind this. The processes are probably not as agile, as dynamic, as smart as they could be, but I think you didn't question this. I'm a little bit concerned about the process not really respecting these matrix structures. So when you said, okay, there are these connectivity things coming from consortia, they are coming, of course, from standardization organizations, it's just horizontal, it's the ETSI ITU world. And I think it's important that we respect that there is a kind of a matrix, that we are partly having an overlap, that we are not really doing very well in understanding how the others are working, and the round table should be a round table also between the standardization organizations, because there is still a problem that I indicate with this table there. There is still a problem understanding the different work procedures, and you were talking about work procedures, in the horizontal and vertical standardization organizations. And that's a little bit blocking. And that wouldn't be a problem because you can say, okay, we are controlling the vertical domain, and that is where money is generated. Yes, you could see it like this. But on the other hand, are you sure that the tech companies coming with solutions from the horizontal level, yeah, are really unsuccessful? So is it that we are really fast enough? Or could it be that there are tech companies coming from really these big markets, these horizontal markets, and are just grabbing parts of the business? Yeah? Being successful in expanding in from this level in certain areas. I'm thinking about all the big US IT companies that are entering vertical domains, and they are successful mainly because they are faster. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I do not completely agree that I agree that a good standard takes time, but I do not agree that a successful standard has the possibility to need time. Yeah, so it might well be, and you know, Napoleon once said, I need successful officers, mm-hmm. no good officers. And I'm a little bit afraid that we are having a similar discussion about standards. So we need successful standards mm-hmm. and not good standards. And that means if the market wants to be faster, then we have to be mm-hmm. faster. Yeah, even if we need to compromise or we simply need to improve the processes. Mm-hmm. I said, if you look at the IoT world, they are much faster. It's not that there is not an example. Yeah. So the IoT is partly answering this. I think you already indicated in the same direction. So IoT is partly starting to dominate in the answer because it's more agile. Mm-hmm. Okay, sorry for this.
Sorry to interrupt, yes. But for the IoT perspective, if you have like the news coming up with IoT botnets attacking from unsafe solutions, providing DDoS attacks to infrastructures, etc., because London CCTV cameras are not sure. Yeah. This is when you have a proprietary standard, to put it this way, which has not been developed with a focus on security, takes some time and has something like TTCN3 testing or et cetera, whatever. So fast doesn't mean good, and proprietary, so standards.
Yeah, fast doesn't mean good. I completely agree. Fast doesn't automatically mean good, but it might be important for being successful. Yeah.
Well, we can discuss that in the process.
At the end, design follows business, and there are only a very few systems that survived. Also, customer didn't want it to buy it.
Okay. I'd like to get your view on that, Eva.
Well, it's again, we are talking about ITU, we are talking about Etsy and so on. That's again, we need to add this part of standardization to our processes just to be as successful as Etsy and as successful as ITU, just to have the possibility to start early discussion and to agree on some ideas and some solutions. And then in the right process, of course, we can still adjust the process and to improve it, but with the following the WTO principles and so on, then prepare the safe standards.
Okay.
And good standards.
Okay, thank you. Now we have another contribution.
Yeah, so you have to congratulate the people who put this building together and the function of the building. In that every idea is important. And all of the ideas shared today, they're all important. I think everyone is saying that standards take too long for commerce, for safety, for security. So one idea, and it comes back to the last speaker, is as you put an idea for a product on the table and you use artificial intelligence, why wouldn't intelligence pull off all of the existing standards that relate to the product, so you start a draft standard? And then when it sees the need for the connections, that it puts it all together. Wouldn't that be a fabulous thing? That you're using artificial intelligence to create the first draft of the standard, and then you get the standard organization to try and fine-tune it to meet, you know, human needs.
Mm-hmm. Eva, what would be your first thought on that?
Well, I'm not an engineer, so I'm not sure if I.
That's why I'm asking you.
answer this question because I'm very keen of artificial intelligence, and I use a lot of IT tools. But I think that. At the end or at the start of any artificial intelligence is the human being. Yeah, someone has to program and prepare and so on and so on. So we have to also remember about it. So
okay.
Well, yeah.
One more.
That is certainly somebody has to program it. Yeah. Yes, and of course a human should be in a central role. But on the other hand, I agree very much with this viewpoint. That was what I call the evolutionary step that is already ongoing. So of course you can use, in order to speed up the process, yeah, you can use artificial intelligence and other smart tools, what we call these XMLification, to get standards created, in particular when we thought about standards engineering. So if for the vertical domains, we need to bring bits and pieces from different standardization worlds together to get these created faster. And then to run through refinement process, we can even do the verification by artificial intelligence. The refinement process, yes, let's see how much refinement is possible, but we should definitely run through the process in order to gain credibility. I agree to this. But so I support this view. That is exactly what I wanted to say. Let's use the tools to solve the problem that we all agree to. We need to speed up. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that would be what I would propose to do. It will also help to somehow handle this problem of communication between the different standardization groups. And it would also help to address the concern of the processes and the question, how often do we need and how do we prepare to have these kind of tools? So we must get out of this paperwork. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Into a more modern world of standardization where we somehow modularize and work with functionalities that we engineer and allow tools to help us to do so, or at least to prepare to do so.
So again, a lot of new ideas. And ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to close the discussion at this point. And Eva and gentlemen, stay with me because we still have our second app poll to do with the audience, and we do want to also communicate the results from the earlier app poll. So you all know already how to do that, and I think, and I know many, some of you at least have voted already on the question we did before. So take out your smartphones again and navigate again to the ReLab agenda main menu. And then select the pulse and this, well, the session you're in, then the pulse and the poll you want to take, and submit your response, please. So, will artificial intelligence replace the experts for standardization? We asked that earlier. And the first choice was yes, fully, because main machines are more effective. Yes, mainly was the second option, as standards will be produced machine readable. The third option was rather not. Creativity of humans can't be beaten by machines. And the fourth, never. Humans will still be the center of activity. So, once again, please take your vote. And while you take your vote, Matthias, you're voting, okay?
Yeah, of course.
Let me ask you, what are you voting?
Oh, no.
So, Eva, you already...
Privacy issues.
What would you think will be the result?
Well, I can now observe the tendencies, so I think that rather not.
So what should be the result from your point of view?
Well, I think that artificial intelligence, it should be used as much as possible, but at the end, as I said, there is a human being.
Okay.
So I think rather not.
Christoph?
Yeah, the result is pretty clear. We need experts to develop the standards, but during the discussion we already lined out that all that supportive work or so could be substantially improved and then supported by tools and means like artificial intelligence. But I agree, we need the experts, but maybe the tools, that's what could be helpful here.
So Hans Schotten, I think, well, we see just a slight actual difference between the two votings. And well, you showed us your view earlier. So this is rather an evolutionary approach, is it? So what do you say now? Do you?
This sounds like an evolution. Yeah, like an evolution, and that majority seems to believe in evolution, but not in revolution. The question is this a big surprise in a round of standardization professionals? That might have been different if you go in a group of researchers that look at this from outside. But for me, it's perfectly fine, because I would probably also have voted that there will be a role for the humans. I would just say that the part in the processes will have to change faster than we assume, but never without humans. So I wouldn't have voted for one or four, but for two or three. And from this point of view, I'm happy.
And you still have a mission to complete?
No, because I have described visions. I have not claimed that I believe that it's a good idea to follow the disruptive approach.
Okay. Yeah,
because, as I said very much in the beginning, standardization is much more than just a technology or a technical question. It is something that is also having an impact on cultural diversity. And for this, I don't want to miss humans being in control and humans taking care that cultural diversity is guaranteed, even if we homogenize technology.
But do you agree when I say sometimes the disruptive approach is needed to get evolution on the way?
I agree to this, and I would even go one step beyond this and say, if you are not aware of disruptive options, you will pretty soon see that there is disruption. So I think it is important for standardization to understand that things are changing and that there are alternative ways to do it, where artificial intelligence is not the issue. I think IoTs are the issue, So IoTs are faster and they are more eager, and they might replace partly standardization. Artificial intelligence is a second wave.
Okay, thank you very much. I take this as a very nice final remark. Thank you so much for that. Thank you to the three of you. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for participating so actively in this session now. We will continue with our next session here in the Reinvention Lab shortly, already in, well, 50, 55 minutes, so at 2 p.m. this afternoon. We will speak about managing the complexity, what we can learn from standardization for e-mobility, a question that probably many of you are interested in, and we'll be very happy to see you back here. Meanwhile, have a nice break, and we'll see you back here. Thanks for attending. Bye-bye.
IEC General Meeting 2016. Connecting communities. Reinvent standardization.